This nuclear agreement may be a done deal, but the arguments are far from over. And joining us now from Washington is Mark Dubowitz. He is with the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies and is a leading critic of this agreement. And Joel Rubin with the Washington Strategy Group. And so, Mark, first question to you. At the very least, would you concede that this deal, as it stands right now, is better than the status quo?
Johnny, I don't think it is, actually. I mean, right now, Iran is in a very weak state. Its economy is under severe pressure. And the Iranians desperately need a deal. They desperately need their economy to recover, because without a recovering economy, it may precipitate, actually, a political change in Iran that the supreme leader and the hardliners do not want to see.
Because without this agreement, the argument is Iran will just return to full-scale uranium enrichment.
Well, the reality is that the Iranians have expanded their program incrementally over the years. They don't engage in massive nuclear expansion. The problem is, with this deal, if Iran just merely complies with this deal, within a decade or so, Iran will have a massive nuclear program, near zero nuclear breakout, and will also have a powerful economy increasingly immunized against our ability to use peaceful economic pressure.
And Joel, that is the criticism. That is the big criticism. Iran doesn't have to do anything, just has to bide its time. And within 15 years, by 2030, it will be a nuclear-armed state and it'll have a pretty good economy to boot.
Well, if that were the case, then I wouldn't support that. But that is not the case. John, this deal is a good deal. It's a deal that blocks all of Iran's pathways to a nuclear bomb. The American intelligence community backs us up. Our nuclear weapons labs and experts back it up. The international community backs us up. I have confidence in their assessment of this deal and how it will block that path.
So can you guarantee that at the end of the 15 years that the Iranians won't be armed with some kind of nuclear weapon?
Yes, you can. This is a very strong agreement. This agreement guarantees that Iran has committed to never producing a nuclear weapon. It puts in place a 10-year deal that will be verifiable on what they have in their capacity for developing their nuclear program. That's normal for nuclear arms agreements. Arms control agreements typically go 10 years or 15 years, then they get renewed. The U.S. did this with the Soviet Union several times. It's normal. What we will see is, as a result of this deal, a breakout time extended to 1 year. We'll see multiple tripwires along the way. If Iran cheats, we'll know it. We'll have time to react.
And Mark, do you agree with that? Do you think that there is enough safeguards in place here that the Iranians, you know, will not have any kind of nuclear weapons in 15 years from now?
You know, I got to tell you, John, that's a really bold claim that Joel just made, that he absolutely guarantees that Iran will not have a nuclear weapon ever, which is quite amazing. My approach to the Middle East is I assume the worst of the Middle East and get surprised on the upside rather than assuming the best in the Middle East and getting devastated on the downside. I wasn't in Washington in 2003 in the run-up to the war in Iraq, but my recollection and my assessment is that there were too many people who were overly optimistic that there will be a transformational moment in the Middle East by invading Saddam and invading what turned out to be a non-existent nuclear weapon program. If Joel really believes that the intelligence community is going to get it right, then he's got to explain why they got it wrong on China, the Soviet Union, India, Pakistan, North Korea, Syria, underestimated Iraq in 1990 and overestimated in 2003.
Okay. I'm happy to explain that. The people that led us to war in Iraq, that misused the intelligence that Mark is right now criticizing correctly, are the same people opposing this nuclear agreement. We can't listen to those people again. Dick Cheney should not be running America's foreign policy again. What he did and what that Iraq war did was unleash Iran onto the Middle East. It unleashed Iran's ability to develop a nuclear program. This administration has put that into a box through strong sanctions, through building an international coalition of pressure. And no, I can't guarantee that Iran will never get the bomb. What I can guarantee is that this deal, if implemented fully, will block them from getting that. And there are mechanisms in place that if they cheat, we will catch them and be able to respond with the backing of our allies, which we did not have in the case of Iraq.
And Mark, isn't that really the point here, that, you know, diplomacy and politics is the art of the possible? I know you put in a number of, issues forward that you would like to see in any future agreement. You're not opposed to any deal, you just want a better deal. But
Correct.
At the end of the day, this is what the Iranians agreed to, and if nothing else, it will at least slow down Iran's march towards a nuclear weapon.
Well, actually, President Obama disagrees with Joel, because President Obama said that it's not going to permanently cut off pathways to a nuclear weapon. It merely will contain Iran for 15 years. The problem, of course, is that this deal could have been a better deal without massive U.S. giveaways. We've got John Kerry, who supported the Iraq war, Joe Biden, who supported the Iraq war, and Hillary Clinton, who supported the Iraq war, who actually are supporting the Iran deal, and we've got John Kerry guaranteeing that the U.S. intelligence community has absolute knowledge. Now, with respect to this deal, over 300 times in U.S. history, Congress has rejected international agreements and called for the amendments to those agreements. It happened during the Cold War. It happened during arms control negotiations with the Soviet Union. It's happened many times. I'm calling for a better deal. I'm calling for follow-on agreements with very specific amendments, not to go back to zero enrichment, not to go back to the dismantlement the administration promised, but with very specific amendments that will improve this deal. It's happened over 300 times in congressional history.
That's,
it can happen again.
Last word to Joel.
If I may, John, and Mark, with all due respect, that's a fantasy. This has been a negotiation for 2 years. You yourself predicted the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action or the predecessor, the interim agreement, would fail. It did not. It brought Iran into a position where its program had been rolled back, and it's going to be rolled back further. Secretary Kerry, Clinton, they voted, authorized the war, but they did not pull the trigger, and they have opposed that invasion in retrospect, said it was a mistake, but the people opposing this negotiation have not.
Joel, the only thing that's a fantasy. Joel, the only thing that's a fantasy is the fundamental belief that Iran will permanently not have a nuclear weapon. The problem is that when it comes to the Middle East, delusions and hope and change are the
that
place
is not delusions. What that is a lasting, verifiable agreement, a verifiable agreement that has that commitment in paper. And if Iran doesn't live up to it, we will have ways to respond. And that is significantly better than the alternative which you're proposing, which leaves us with no agreement, no verification, no international coalition, and no sanctions.
That leaves us right now out of time.
All right,
guys, thank you so much,
John.
Thank you both
for
being with us. We appreciate your views.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.